Good morning, class. So today we're going to continue our lesson into chapter 3, lesson 5. And the title of this lesson is Displacement, Velocity, and Acceleration. You can open your book, page 92. Page 92. So actually this lesson is more about physics. It's about how displacement can relate to velocity and how can velocity relate to acceleration. So, if you have learned that actually derivative is an instantaneous rate of change. So it's a rate of change with respect to any variable that we can say of. So if you have a displacement function, let's say you have a displacement function. And then you want to find the derivative of displacement. It means you are trying to find the rate of change of the displacement, right? So if we make the derivative with respect to time, so actually displacement is divided by time. And when displacement is divided by time, then you will get a velocity. And then if we continue, if we find the derivative of velocity, it means we are trying to find the instantaneous rate of change of the velocity with respect to time again. So it's basically velocity divided by time. And you know in physics, when velocity is divided by time, then you will get an acceleration. So this is the flow when you derive a displacement derived with respect to time becomes velocity, velocity derived with respect to time becomes acceleration. Okay, so now that you know the relation between displacement, velocity, and acceleration, now you need to be able also to determine whether a moving object is going up or going down. You need to be able for a moving object, you need to be able to determine if it's going up or going down, or is it speeding up or slowing down. Okay, now the principle when we are talking about derivative, instantaneous rate of change, it means that if the velocity is positive, if the velocity is positive, then actually we can conclude that the object is going up because the slope is positive, right? It means it goes. The y increase, the object is increases, the position of the object is increasing while the x is increasing, while the time is increasing, right? And also the same with going down. When the velocity of an object, of a moving object is negative, then actually the object is going down. Okay. So, now how to determine whether an object is speeding up or slowing down? So in your book, actually, there is the principle, page 94. There's the box there, the green, green box. So basically, if the velocity and the acceleration, they have the same sign, which both positive or both negative, then actually they are speeding up. Okay. But when velocity and acceleration having a different sign, then actually the object is slowing down. Okay. Now let's see example two, so you get, you understand what I just taught you. Example two on your book, page 95. Okay. The object in example one moves in the x direction with displacement from the y axis given by, so the displaced x is the displacement function. X is equal to 3t cubed minus 30t squared plus 64t plus 57. Well, the t is greater than zero, of course. I mean, there is no such thing that the t is a negative term. Well, x is in miles and t is in hours. Find the equation for its velocity and acceleration. So like I say, as x is in a displacement. So if you want to find the velocity, we need to derive x with respect to time, which is dx dt, or also can be written as velocity, which is equal to 27 t cube t square minus 60t. I mean, it's supposed to be 9, I'm sorry. 9t squared minus 60t plus 64. Okay. And then if you want to find the acceleration, then we derive velocity with respect to time. Dv dt, which is the acceleration, which is equal to 18t minus 60. So x is the displacement, dx dt is the velocity, and dv dt is the acceleration. Or actually, this can be also written as the second derivative, dx of ddx of dx dt. So it's basically we derive displacement two times. And the way you can write it, the terminology, you can write it as d2x dt squared, like this. So this means that it is actually the second derivative of displacement, the second derivative of function x. Okay. Now let's move on to b. Find the velocity and acceleration at t equals 2, t equals 4, and t equals 6. At each time, state whether x is increasing or decreasing, at what rate, and state whether the object is speeding up or slowing down, and how do you decide. So the book already give the table. I'll just take the table from the book. So this is t, this is v, and this is a, and there is 2, 4, 6. And if the t is 2, the v is equal to negative 20. This is negative 32. This is 28. This is negative 24, 12, and 48. So how do we get the v and the t? Of course, we just need to substitute the value of t into the equation. Right? In this one. Okay. So if this is the case, now let's examine when t equals 2. When t equals 2, the v is negative. The v is negative. So if the v is negative, is it going up or going down? Then it's definitely going down, decreasing. Or decrease. Okay. And then let's see. How about the relation of the velocity and the acceleration? Does it have the same sign? It does have the same sign, which is negative sign. So actually we can conclude that it is speeding up. Okay. Now let's look at when t equals 4. When t equals 4, the v is negative. So it's again, it's going down. Or decreasing. And then the V and the A have a different sign. the V is negative, the A is positive. So that means that actually the object is slowing down at this moment. Okay. And then the last one, when the T equals 6, the V is positive. So actually the object is going up or increasing, increase. Okay, increase. And because the V and the A have the same sign, which is positive sign, so actually the object is speeding up. Okay, so that's the example two. That's how you determine whether an object is going up or going down, or speeding up or slowing down, and also how to find the velocity and the acceleration if the function of displacement is given. And then the next one that I want to discuss, that I want to teach you, is the term antiderivative. Antiderivative. So antiderivative is actually the reverse of the derivative. So like I said before, if we have displacement, we derive become velocity, and then we derive the velocity become acceleration. If we, so this is the flow of the derivative. Now also there is a reverse flow that is called antiderivative. So if we antiderivative acceleration, the result will be a velocity, antiderivative. And then if we antiderivative velocity, then the result will be a displacement. So this is the flow of the antiderivative. Okay, let's see example 3 on your book, page 96 for the antiderivative problem. So the acceleration of a moving object is given by a of t equals 12t minus 5. So a of t equals 12t minus 5. Well, a t is, that's the unit. If the velocity, and then it's given that the velocity when t equals 1, is equal to 8 centimeter per minute. Find the equation for velocity as the velocity a function of t, and then use to find the velocity at the instance t equals 3. So we need to find vt, and we need to find v of 3. Okay, so the problem is the information given is the acceleration instead of the displacement. So we need to do antiderivative. Okay. So Vt will be equal to the antiderivative of 12t minus 5. Now for antiderivative, you need to think, you need to imagine, you need to determine what function that if we derive, the result is 12t minus 5. So because it's a subtraction problem, so actually we can see it one by one. So let's see from 12t first. What is the function in term of t that if we derive, then the result is 12t? Then of course, because this is a power function, you know that the derivative, the power of the variable will decrease by 1, right? So of course, if you want to get t as the derivative, you need to have t squared on the original equation. And then we want to have 12, we only have, so what coefficient do we need to put here? Then you know that if we derive t squared, it's 2t, right? So we need a 6 as a multiplier to multiply with the t squared. So the derivative of 6t squared is equal to 12t. And then how about 5? What function is derived? The result is 5. Of course, it is 5t. Simple. And then because this is an antiderivative, don't forget to add plus a constant. Because a constant, when you derive a constant, the result will be zero, right? So this is an uncertain constant that you need to put when you do the process of antiderivative. Now, why is the time equals one given? Because that information is needed to find the C. So we know that the V of one is equal to 8, is equal to when V equals, and when T equals one, then actually it's equal to 6 minus 5 plus C, right? So we have 8 equals 1 plus C. So we know that in this case, the C is equal to 7. So with this, we can determine the formula for Vt, which is equal to 6t squared minus 5t plus 7. Yeah, and then when you want to find V of 3, then it's easy. Just substitute the t equals 3, which is 6 times 9 minus 5 times 3. Plus 7, which is 54 minus 15 plus 7, which is equal to 6146. Am I right? Yes, 46. Okay, so that's antiderivative. So look at the definition of antiderivative. Function g is an antiderivative of indefinite integral. Later on, we will learn that actually indefinite integral is the same with antiderivative. Function g is an antiderivative of function f if and only if g prime x is equals to fx. Okay, so g is antiderivative of fx if and only if g prime x is equals to. So this is the definition of antiderivative. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you.